Surprise, motherfucker.
Jesus Christ.
Welcome everybody, I'm RJ of the Nerdy Brew, and here on this channel we talk TV, movies and everything in between, all while drinking a cup of coffee. Now if you like one of these things, or all of these things, why don't you consider like, subscribing and hit that notification bell, and becoming a fellow brewster. So today, fellow brewsters, this is a coffee talk, and I'm not going to remain in that accent. It was kind of straining my voice, so I'm not going to do that. But I'm just coming in the house or running some errands. And I just wanted to have this conversation with you before the day goes on. And hopefully that we can visit. And I hope that you're doing well. And thank you for stopping by, having this cup of coffee with your boy. And also, I want you to don't give up, don't give in, and stay determined. But within this coffee talk, we're going to be talking about Dracula of 2013 that premiered on NBC, and I just want to tell you that I have to share my thoughts. The show has a great modern adaptation of what Dracula is. And so the thing is, Dracula is a pop culture icon. You know, the original book was made in 1897, right? Or it took place in 1897. Bram Stoker was the man that made it. And I guess it's written out like journal entries from different perspectives. But I've never read the book personally myself. I've seen the Francis Ford Coppola Dracula. I've seen the Frank Langella Dracula. I've seen the Christopher Lee Dracula. So I've seen five. And I've also seen the Netflix rendition of Dracula. And I've also seen the one that we're going to discuss, is the Dracula of 2013. So with all the other movie iterations, you know, you even got the count that was in Sesame Street.
Greetings, it is I, the Count, and it's time to answer that fascinating question, what is the Sesame Street number of the day?
You know, vampires are in our zeitgeist, right? They're in our cultural zeitgeist. I went to New Orleans and learned about, you know, certain vampires, went past a vampire cafe. So, it's around. Vampires are around. I'm a big fan of Klaus from the originals. I'm a big fan of Klaus from the originals. You know, the Vampire Diaries was okay. Not necessarily fully my stilo, but the originals like pumped up the show for me. So I definitely, you know, enjoy Klaus and the Michelsons. I love that dynamic, and I just thought that was amazing writing. But I was feeling curious about Jonathan Rhys Meyers, and I did watch Tutors, and he was also in, not Mission Impossible, which he was in, but he was also in Vikings. And I was just like, yo, he's a captivating dude. I know that he had a show and I never watched it, so I was like, yo, I'm gonna give myself some time to watch this show. So I ended up watching it, and I'm like, while I'm watching the show, I'm like, why was this show canceled? Like, this show seems to be a very engaging, like, there's a lot of good pluses about the show that I'm going to talk about. And I was like, I don't understand why this show got canceled. And I do need to look into the details about the show, like why it got canceled. But definitely I need to understand that, because watching it as a show, it was a great viewing experience. And it's not hard to watch. It was 10 episodes, and each episode built on one another. And the thing is, when it comes to the show, spoilers. So the show has the characters and it has like the backdrop of the Dracula novel, and the character is definitely Dracula Vlad Tempest, you know? What they do is adding a whole different narrative to the show. So let's say in the original Dracula, right? From my knowledge of the Francis Ford Coppola one. So in the Francis Ford Coppola one, there's the ending chase scene, and Van Helsing, Abraham Van Helsing is in there, and they do their work to kill Dracula, right? But this show has its own narrative starting. So I don't know certain plot points, but when it comes from like the 2021, and if the 2020 is an adaptation of the book, I know the ending from the book, like all the other endings were totally different from the 2021 on Netflix. I definitely gotta say that this show crafted a good show, and a good show for network television. So at the starting of the show, first of all, it starts off totally different. It starts off in a place where you got these two men bundled up in this clothing, right? And they're in a tomb. And they're in the tomb, and it's two dudes, right? So one dude, they find the tomb, and then they open up the tomb, like with the tools to open up a tomb, and mad gold comes out. They got so much gold in there. And the dude who's with them is like, yo, we're rich. Like the one who opens up the tomb is like, yo, we're rich. There's so much gold. And then the next man, we don't see his face, and he ends up slitting his throat and start just draining blood all over the corpse, ends up reanimating and waking up, and it ends up being Dracula. So the man who did that was the actor Thomas Kretschmann. And Thomas Kretschmann, if you don't know him, he was one of the elder vampires in Blade 2. He was also in The Pianist. He was in the movie Downfall. He was in King Kong. He's a very regular actor. But this time he's playing Abraham Van Helsing. And it's like, wait a minute, you know, from what we know from pop culture, it's like Van Helsing is usually the enemy of Dracula. What is he doing waking up Dracula in this show? So that's what comes to be the mystery, and that, but they put that up really early. So come to find out that, come to be part of the Knights Order, known as the Order of the Dragon. So the historical Vlad the Impaler was part of this order. His family was, his father, his brother, they were all part of the Knights of the Order of the Dragon. So in the show, Van Helsing is part of the Order of the Dragon in the show, but they betrayed him and killed his family. So back when Vlad Tempest was Vlad Tempest in Transylvania, they killed his wife, who was Mina Harker, or who looked like Mina Harker. That's another thing. Yeah, and then they tortured him, and then they dumped his body. And that's what happened to him. So Van Helsing, yeah, the time of 1897 was the one that resurrected him. They have common goals, common alignment of getting rid of the Order of the Dragon. And now the Order of the Dragon is no longer a knight's organization. They ended up becoming more like the Illuminati, and it's men who's involved in money. The crux of the problem is. So the issue is, it's in their present day of 1897. And when you have Van Helsing, right, is working along with Dracula, but Dracula is playing the chess game, right? A long con and a ruse, how he's playing the game, because he arrives in London, and with him being in London, he is being Dracula, right? Who's also being British. That's his real like persona, not Transylvanian, but he's being a British man. playing an American named Alexander Grayson. So there was layers upon layers upon layers about the ruse and the performance that he was trying to play.
Who are you?
Me? I know who I am.
I'm a dude playing a dude disguised as another dude.
What?
So there was no last voyage of the Demeter in regards to the show, but he ends up arriving in London, and as Alexander Grayson, he's playing this performance of Alexander Grayson, who's this American businessman industrialist since it's the height of the industrial age. And so what he's trying to do is come in with this business idea, take money away from the Order of the Dragon. So what he's doing is developing air technology like Tesla was doing. So it could be free flowing energy through the air. So that's what he's building to. And he's trying to get investors to take money away from the Order of the Dragon because everybody is involved in oil and coal and all the industrial things during the height of the 19th century of the industrial age. So he's trying to change that, but also he's playing a whole different game. So the Order of the Dragon has a female vampire hunter, and through the show, she is killing vampires, and her name is Lady Jane. And the thing about Lady Jane, Dracula gets her very infatuated with their intercourse, right? So she is pingmatized by what he's laying down on her. So she's just all involved in him. So he got her distracted from that. And he's also being a vampire in this world. So he's out here eating. So it's a mystery, like, who is this vampire that is in the city eating? And I'm trying to hunt him down, and she's very close. But the two lives, they never cross, only with him trying to get her off the board in a manner of their lustful exploits. But also, when it comes to this, he gets Jonathan Harker. And so for those who don't know, Jonathan Harker was Keanu Reeves in the Francis Ford Coppola film. So we have Oliver Jackson playing Jonathan Harker. And the thing about Jonathan Harker and what he did, Alexander Grayson, Dracula, he's really green. He's wet under the ears as a lawyer. But he's a lawyer in the sense of he's pure. He's pure, he's not tainted, and he's not part of the Order of the Dragon. So Count Dracula wants to use his naivete for all his work. So that's what happens. But what comes to find out is that he sees Mina Harker, who is a reincarnated version of his wife. And that's the same thing that happened in the Francis Ford Coppola film. So the thing that he does is, like, he big balling status, Alexander Grayson Dracula. And so he's like, he offers Jonathan Harker a job. He's paying for, like, lavish things for him and Mina. And he's just, like, coming off as this charismatic gentleman. And he's like, yeah, whatever you need, I got it. You know what I'm saying? I'm breaking bed, let it rain. So that's what he was doing in front of them. And it was like, wait a minute. What is going on? And he's like, my boss is great. And that's all he's thinking during the time. It's like, my boss is great. And she is coming from family. And the thing about their relationship is what I loved about the show. It allowed the relationship to have troubles. So at first, when you meet them as a couple, you see them in a place of, like, fresh cupcake love, right? And then he goes out with the boys, gets drunk. She finds out, like, he says things. He's like, yeah, I try to be supportive, but she's trying to be a modern woman and she has her own endeavors, and I'm gonna turn her into a housewife. And she's like, wait a minute, so you lied. Like, your pretenses the entire time was to get me knocked up and have me just stay at home when you know that I'm trying to be more than, you know, what I am and what society says. So because that happens, that brings a division in a relationship. And because that happens, that allows Dracula to go in and slither his way in. But the dedication to one another in their relationship, what allows them to be a compelling couple. You have Nansu and Zali. And Nansu and Zali, he was one of the slavers in Game of Thrones that Dany trapped in Meereen. and he plays Renfield. And, you know, there was just the movie that came out of Renfield. And so in Renfield, he's Dracula's number two. Because he's Dracula's number two and he's maneuvering in this world with Dracula, he says that he speaks for Dracula. So, but he's not called, it's Mr. Grayson. So he's saying that he's speaking for Mr. Grayson. So him speaking for Mr. Grayson, he has to demand respect because it's still 1897 and he's a black man. So that's kind of like the tension that he goes through. But the Order of the Dragon end up doing deductive reasoning and think that Alexander Grayson is Dracula. So the entire show is tit for tat of these machinations and these grand schemes of one-upping each other. And that's where the intrigue comes from. That's where the mystery comes from. That's where the captivation of the show comes from, of molding a very, you know, engaging and mystery-filled show. Now, I just gotta say this about Abraham Van Helsing, and what he does in the show is everybody is playing in each other in this show. The only one that's purely not being, who doesn't have a stake in trying to manipulate or stab somebody in the back is Mina Harker. She's the only one. I'm not gonna say that she's being used, but everybody else within the show have their own motives of doing things deceitfully. And she's the only one who's just trying to just like move along and get along type situation. Van Helsing, and with Van Helsing, is he's working along with Dracula to get revenge on the Order of the Dragon. But the thing is this, is that this man is working behind the scenes to also dispose of Dracula. So it's like, how does that get in tied with their relationship, and how does that look within their relationship? So that's something to look into. And I gotta just say this, like, not only with the cast being phenomenal, but Jonathan Rhys Meyers' portrayal of Dracula is a masterclass in itself. He brings charisma, depth, a sense of vulnerability to the character, making him both menacing and sympathetic. And then, like, the chemistry between him and, like, whoever that he has to, like, act with is so sizzling. And just everything that they do within the cast is just top notch. And that's one thing that, like threw me over, like, dang, they really acting. Like, I'm like, man, this delivery is fire. So not only did the acting got me so invested in the show, to me, what made me love this show even more was the production value of the show. So inside the show, it was such a visual feast, like the set designs, the costumes, everything transported you to 19th century, all the attention and all the detail of, you know, that time in London. And then, like, it's the effects, the cinematography, it was gothic with a great dark atmosphere, and it was haunting and beautiful at the same time, and it was very immersive. They probably had about like three sets, but every time that they transported you in the sets, the detailing and the lighting of the sets just was able to allow you to have a visual treat of sitting within the scene. And how they just like frame these scenes made it very engaging. So I could talk more and more about how good this show was. So for me, I told you about the adaptations that I do know about. But I gotta say, what's really intriguing about this particular adaptation of the themes that it explores, and also the social commentary, because it delves into the issues of power and revenge, corrupting influence, and how influence of wealth constructs society in that kind of narrative, and it adds depth and substance within the storyline, not making it just about vampires, but also making it a tale about the reflection on society at the time. And the thing about vampires They're always elitist, and not only they're elitist, they're also blood-sucking. And that's what, like, kind of like the commentary is of this, like, bourgeoisie atmosphere encroaching on those who are lesser and feeding off of that. So that's kind of like themes that they go through. But the crazy thing is like, this man of Alexander Gracian / Dracula is a man who is ambitious on more than one front. So he has to fulfill his physical need to feed, but he's also trying to gain a certain notoriety and certain status. And that kind of motive, there's always pride before the fall. But, you know, I'll say this though, like, if you're a fan of the novel, if you're a fan of any of the films, or if you're a fan of a character, you'll appreciate how this adaptation is a homage to all of those other works, but it's also very original and it's adding its own unique flavor. It's a fresh take on Dracula that stands out among other adaptations, which is not an easy feat all in itself. I don't know what everybody thought of the 2020 version that was on Netflix, but I say if you feel like you need to watch a captivating and intriguing and precise show, I definitely say go back and look for Dracula 2013. But you can't forget the music. The music of the show was haunting and beautiful and enhances the viewing experience. And not only did it enhance the viewing experience, it just set the tone of each scene, and it was placed in a way to show the emotion and the intensity of how it's supposed to. And that's what makes a good, you know, viewing experience. When you're watching a movie or if you're watching a show, how well is the music placed to set the scene? So it is amazing atmospheric backdrop of how well the music was done, the production, everything about it. So Dracula 2013, it's a hidden gem worth sinking your teeth into. It has a captivating story, outstanding performances, and it has amazing production value. And it has a stand-up adaptation of the iconic vampire legend. I'm saying I highly recommend, if you could give it a watch, and if you're a fan of dark atmospheric dramas with a supernatural twist, please give it a chance. So I want to give a shout out to Profess84 for commenting. Thank you for being here. Thank you for taking this time out. I appreciate you. I appreciate your engagement. So if you want yourself to have a shout out, make sure that you comment. That's all I ask. It's going to go a long way, especially in goals and endeavors. But also, thanks for joining me, diving into the world of Dracula 2013. If you enjoyed this review, like, comment, subscribe, all that other stuff. Have you seen this adaptation of Dracula? Let me know your thoughts about Dracula, vampire lore, whatever you care to talk about. You know where my head is at. You definitely could go see my views of Castlevania. I'll leave it at the end of the video. But thank you for taking this time out to visit with me, have this conversation with me. I have to get on with my day, and I want your day to be successful and safe. And I'm going to bring this video to an end. And I want you to be you, do you, see the bigger picture. Have a fantastic day, because you deserve it. This is that channel. It's going to take 8 hours for a 20-minute video. Please subscribe. All right, peace. Cat mouth on top, Kung Fu, Bruce Lee chop, Moon rocks, go Red Sox, trying to go far like Boondocks. Headshot, blunt stay high, talking shit, gotta pull up on they block. You fraud, I'm couch guard, no, you got a tax like a state charge. Safe house, safe house, safe house.